Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As they say in the Western Division, Dolavena, and a good evening. I was talking to the good doctor, and I really want him to be my campaign manager. I'm not here to campaign, but he talked about the election, so I feel like I have to say that he needs to be the campaign manager. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, the president of the association and the executives of the association, of course, all the dental dentists and other dental associated personnel that's here, thank you for the invitation. As was said, I'm a bit of a ring-in. I was asked yesterday by a president to come because they could not make it. So it gives me much pleasure to be here. I came because you do play a very pivotal role. But I also have to tell you that you played a very important role in how I raise up my children. Because you are the very people I use as a threat. So when they're in discipline, I say, I'm going to take you to the dentist. As mentioned earlier on, the health system in Fiji, of course, has been going through a number of changes. And there's no doubt that COVID itself brought home a number of issues. A lot of your services was not being delivered. A lot of your services were being put on hold. We had a 1-in-100-year event that really has changed the world quite significantly. We are seeing, just to sort of digress slightly, we are seeing what we call professional preferences change in a number of countries, in particular in the developed world, in the industrialized world. We are seeing a shortage of nurses. The waiting time at Melbourne Hospital, the public hospital system a few months back, was 24 hours. There are many other professions where a lot of people in those countries don't want to work in those areas. Recently, I was at a care facility, in Sydney. In fact, visiting somebody who's related to me who's lived in Australia for about 40, 50 years, and who now needs care. And every single personnel who worked at that care facility was not an Australian. They were Thai, Indonesian, Filipino, Afghani, all sorts of Somalian, all sorts of different nationalities. We had one health center recently in Suva that had six very experienced nurses being poached by another foreign country. There's a shortage of teachers. My brother-in-law, for example, works in rural Australia, where the allowances that they get paid and the salaries that get paid, there's no way you can match it. Because there's a shortage of people who want to teach in those areas. There's a shortage of people who work, for example, in the construction sector. Certain restaurants don't open in New Zealand for lunch and dinner because there's not enough waiters and waitresses, not enough chefs. So the whole industrialized world, there's a huge change in professions. Nurses in UK are being hired from India. There are all sorts of disruptions because of people's professional preference changes. That obviously has an impact on us too. Because if we have people who may leave Fiji as a result of those professional preferences overseas, that could actually create a huge gap for us too. We had a few months back, 60 accountants leave for Australia. Australia has a shortage of accountants. But at the same time, we were talking to one of the large, what they call the big four accounting firms. The chairperson was here in Fiji. We had a meeting with them about how they can shift certain accounting jobs to Fiji, because we actually have a lot of trained professional accountants. The point being, and the reason I'm talking about all of this, is that we need to invest in our people. We need to invest in our people so they can continue to provide those services in Fiji. We need to continue to provide scholarships. So for example, in this year's budget, we've given additional scholarships for midwives, for people to become midwives, for nurses, etc. Salaries have also been increased. And I saw in your focus in the past couple of days has been about primary health care. And you do actually are at the front of that. This is why, you know, we decided, which is kind of, you know, precipitated by COVID itself, where we have this now free GP scheme. So we did not want people going to public health systems for a minor ailment. So now they can go and visit a private doctor and we'll actually pay the fees. And a few months back, we've expanded that to dental. for dental practitioners. So, you know, your treasurer is one of the beneficiaries, your president also. They have an outlet where if people go and, for example, get, filling done, a permanent or temporary filling done, extraction done, or consultation, all of those costs we actually bear as a government. And that what it means from one perspective, it does relieve the public health system from those people lining up because they cannot afford to normally go to a dental practitioner in the private practice. So they now go to private practitioners, they will pay for that. It also means that we can get people in the public health system to focus on more specialized areas. So there's no doubt there's a whole need to invest in that space. And you can be rest assured that that investment, while as has been continuing, will continue to continue. And I think that's critically important. I think the other point that has also been highlighted through what has COVID brought about is that there is definitely a need to get the private sector to work with the public sector. It's important. In Fiji, we've seen the doctors too. The general practitioners tend to be sort of in their own association. Then you have the government practitioners in their own association, Fiji Medical Association. Then I think over here too, I see some private practitioners here. I see one over there. And there's some others maybe who are here too. But there needs to be a lot more of a collaboration between the public and the private sector. That's critically important. It is completely unnecessary to have different associations just because somebody's in the public sector and somebody's in the private sector. Of course, there may be certain challenges that may be unique to that particular sector. However, you should have an umbrella body for all dental practitioners. And then you can have your own specialist areas, And that, I think, is critically important. So please be rest assured. You see, I'm actually bound by many things at the moment. It's a campaign period, so I can't be making promises to you. Otherwise, you'll be seen as I'm buying your vote. So I have to be very restricted. But I think what you need to be able to, as to what I can say, but I think what is really important is for you to be able to understand some of the things that I've just highlighted to you. Dental practitioners need to be able to ensure that they work together, whether they're from the public sector or the private sector. There is a need to adopt technology. There are many procedures and processes that may be very archaic. Even we have recognized that ourselves within the governmental system. Whether it's in terms of documentation of patients, whether it's in terms of how do we actually document those that information itself, and it's the uptake of technology which is critically important. So if you can focus on that. I'm really glad that you have this continuing sort of professional practice. Because any profession that does not have some form of yearly review of how you're running your practice or how you're actually, giving your professional services will in fact not be able to keep up with the times. So we have, for example, with the lawyers, every lawyer every year has to get 10 what they say CLE points, continuing legal education. So in the same way dental practitioners should, in the same way doctors should, in the same way, for example, architects, engineers, etc., because technology changes so rapidly, how you deliver services also changes so rapidly. People now get information not through flyers or leaflets or some poster you put up on your building, but through Facebook. People also can, in a way, harass you as practitioners. Nowadays you may do something that may be slightly that somebody may consider not right, and suddenly they put it up on Facebook. How do you handle that? How do you manage that? It has a huge impact on, I've seen a lot of professionals, when people kind of troll them on Facebook, saying, oh, you did not do this, there was a dirty napkin lying on the table. It may not necessarily have been a big deal, but in fact it gets blown out of proportion. And a lot of people comment on that. So you need to know as a profession, you need to provide that type of support services. So how you can handle that, because psychologically it has a huge impact on professionals. So there's a number of areas that you can actually talk about and think about, and as a profession. And ultimately, please, you must understand that we value all of you. I know there is a need to review the law. The law, goes back to about 2011. There's probably a need to review that. And those are some of the things that we've actually been talking about within the chambers, and I know there's some work going on. So, like I said, I'm somewhat restricted, but those are some of the things on the list that we do need to do. I wish you all. I hope you all had a good 2 days. And you all obviously seem to be very relaxed and all dressed up. I've never seen dentists looking so colorful. So thank you very much also for your perseverance during COVID. I think a lot of people misunderstand or don't seem to grasp the tremendous pressure that was put on the health system. I mean, this is why, for example, when a lot of people were saying that civil servants' pay should be cut, we decided not to cut it. Because how could we do that? You know, there's no way you could do that. I mean, you have nurses going on horseback to deliver vaccines, people working back late. I mean, those are the kind of things that we had to take into consideration. Yes, there were some people who, like teachers, maybe did not go to school for 6 months or 7 months. But we could not, at the expense of others, you know, give people a pay cut. But we feel that by doing so, there needs to be a sense of recognition that you are actually very much worth it. And that at the same time, there's an equal responsibility on you to be able to deliver the services which the members of the public deserve. So ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for the invitation. I wish you a very good evening. I also wish your association, ability to be able to get into more of the nitty-gritty of delivery of professional services. It should not be only once a year. There should be support services. For me, one of the things that I really am keen on is that professionals need a lot of support, in particular with changing technology. In particular with the changing technology that actually brings about also a lot of what I call psychological pressures that may be brought about on professionals. And if you have the support, if you have that network, that can also help you to deliver better services. I had forgotten to mention one thing. I want to acknowledge people like Dr. Arish who are here. There are many Fijians who've left Fiji, you know, some years back. A lot of them have excelled really well in the countries that they have chosen to now reside in or practice their profession. And we are seeing now a return of many of them who want to give back to the country of their birth. And I think there's a great opportunity for us. Recently, as you know, we're now at Lotoka Hospital. We've got open heart surgery now available through this Triple P partnership with Aspen Medical. And what we really want to do with that is not only provide services to ordinary Fijians, but also to tap into the huge level of professionalism, the talent, the skill sets that many Fijians have actually acquired and are living overseas, but we want to encourage them to actually come back and contribute to the country of their birth. And in fact, we have been talking a lot about how we can, in fact, collaborate and synergize all that skill sets that have been developed to ensure that they are able to contribute back to the country of their birth and to be able to ensure that we lift up the health standards and various other professional standards in this country, because that's the only way that we will be able to ensure that not only our citizens get services, but we ourselves can actually become a hub of providing medical services. Because you know that Fiji is really miles ahead of many other countries within the Pacific. And we must take advantage of not just the geographical location, but the enormous levels of service capacity that we have to be just creating more jobs for our own people and building our economy a lot more stronger. So please put your hands together for Dr. Arish to come back and contribute. And I hope that, you know, you continue to come back and work together with us Fijians who live here. Naka, thank you.
Honorable Attorney General, Mr. Khaiyum, heads of dental department, distinguished conference speakers, members of association and all the delegates. First and foremost, a very big thank you to the association for letting us be part of this wonderful conference. We have been sponsoring this event for a number of years, and we hope that we can continue to do this sponsorship for a few more years. I can only imagine how difficult it was for the dental profession to maintain social distancing and follow safe practices while seeing their patients in the period of the pandemic. However, we are all on the road to recovery, and it is great to see you all here after 2 years. We at Colgate stand by and passionately believe in our brands, brand promise that everyone deserves a future they can smile about. It is a lot easier for me to go out there and say that we distribute smiles instead of saying that we sell toothpaste all the time. So I think that's one of the things that we do quite well. Couple of things I want to bring up today is education and sustainability. I think Honorable AG had mentioned a few of those items already. While we see today's conference absolutely sort of reaffirms the association's commitment to continue educating of its own members. Colgate support for education and link to the dental profession has been an integral part of our history and success. Since the beginning here in Fiji in 1974, Colgate has been involved in oral health education, providing schools and communities at large with toothbrush kits and education materials through our Bright Smiles, Bright Future program. This is one of the programs that we are very proud of. I think a lot of elder generation in the association know a lot more about this, and we definitely need to do a better job with our marketing, my marketing team, to make sure that we get this into the new generation, because it is a good education program for the kids. So the BSBF program helps us establish partnership with the government, with the schools and community, and a very strong partnership with the dental profession. Local and global partnerships with dental professions provide deeper and relevant insights on the oral health status and the needs the community we live in, and how we can support the Ministry of Health and other stakeholders to address these needs. We firmly believe it is through education that the knowledge and skills for the service that you provide are gained and enhanced. What got my attention in this conference, or the theme of the conference, which was sustainable dentistry, and it's something that is very relevant in the current times. I know we are all aware, it is, and it is demanded upon us by the new generation to ensure that the basic needs and quality of life of everyone are met for now and for the future generations. The current delivery of healthcare in the modern world is not sustainable due to the rising cost, the rising financial cost, increasing demand, and the higher environmental burden and certainty, and suddenly a challenge for all of us. Medicine in general places a high moral importance on human life, and the speakers today have clearly reminded the team that they must take a holistic and a preventative approach to patient care. Specifically, they should take account of patients' overall health. There is a growing evidence that a healthy planet has a considerable positive impact on human health. Thus, sustainability is a key focus for us as Colgate as well. With Colgate brand in more homes than other, we are presented with great opportunities and new challenges as we work to integrate sustainability in all aspects of our business and create a positive social impact. We are determined to position ourselves for further growth as we act on our 2025 sustainability and social impact strategy based on our three key ambitions: driving social impact, helping millions of homes, and preserving our environment. With these common goals with the dentistry profession and objectives, Colgate is proud of its partnership with all the profession in Fiji. And I would like to say thank you to each one of you for your efforts and contribution. It always supports us in our initiatives and programs. We wouldn't be able to do it without you guys. So with that, a very big thank you once again to the association for its continued partnership. Thank you very much.
Round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Vinaka, Vinaka. A round of applause, everybody. Thank you.
I'm going to go to the partition room.